We're back, we're live, 1 o'clock rock. And today we have a special show. Welcome to Life After Statehood on ThinkTech. I'm your host, Jay Fidel, and our guest and co-contributor for the show is Ray Tsuchiyama. Today our show is called Rail on the Ground. Did I get that right? And we're gonna talk about articles on the subject that Ray wrote and others have written. Our guest is, great to have him here, Ray Tsuchiyama. Welcome to the show.
Happy New Year of the Rooster, and it's great to be here. And we're gonna open the new year with Rail, the giant elephant in the room that's sleeping very quietly.
Well, Rail, Rail has been on and off again, and so this discussion continues, but you know, now it seems to be more ardent. We're in a financial pickle. It's more visible every day. I hope people get that. And we got plans, or lack of plans, that we can't afford. We're lurching. Lurching is not good for any community. So it's time for a change, in my view, and I agree with you absolutely in your article, that we ought to stop, we ought to come down from elevated and get on the ground, you know, with ground rail. Wouldn't that be better for everybody? So let's talk about it. Tell us about your article. Tell us about some of the other articles.
Well, it's not a new idea. And it goes back even to 2009. There was a report commissioned by Kamehameha Schools, in fact, by Mr. Philip Gregg, a consultant, who said, why don't we have a rail system that goes elevated to Middle Street and then at grade on the ground with cars and pedestrians from Middle Street onward to Ala Moana. And oddly enough, that was 2009 at that point. Now, several years later, it's very prophetic when you think about it.
Well, you know, it makes sense in the sense that the long distances, you know, across long, you know, long landscapes over there, you can have elevated rail, and maybe land is easier to achieve there. But when you get into the central part of the city, you really have to, you have to go on the ground for many, many reasons. But I want to tell you a short story.
Go ahead.
My wife and I go to Europe, okay? We drive all over Europe. We love driving in Europe, and everybody does. And we're heading toward Paris from Rouen, which is to the west of Paris. And it's a freeway, you know, and it moves really fast at 120 kilometers an hour or something like that. And all of a sudden, we go into a tunnel. Okay, well, they got tunnels. That's good. We stay in the tunnel. We're driving, you know, many miles or kilometers, you know, tens and 20s and 30s of kilometers in this tunnel. What's going on? And then, at the last minute, the tunnel pops up at the Arc de Triomphe in the center of the city. So, you know, what happened is they put it down so it wouldn't screw up the city, and then you come up in the center of the city. And I think the same concept here. When you're in the countryside, you can have a freeway. When you get in the city, you want to change, you know, change it so that it comports with the city and works better in a sort of the central. And that was useful in Paris, and I think ground rail would be very useful here. But say why.
Well, as I said before, there was a trolley system here in Honolulu that went to the outskirts of the city back then, which was Fourth Shafter Middle Street. So oddly enough, all these geographic points come back to our discussion. First of all, it's about construction costs. Elevated rail takes hundreds of tons of concrete to put up. Once you have a rail station, and that's a major cost by itself, and a series of rail stations, well, you just can't say, oh, we made a mistake, we have to move the station. You're stuck with that station forever and ever for time. At grade stations, you can move them around. You can say, well, we'll put one here, but it didn't attract so many people. We're gonna shift it about 100 meters this way or that way. And at ground, it services categories of people who may find a elevated station more challenging. The elderly, the handicapped, people with bicycles, surfers with surfboards, children, all those categories would find, and tourists would love to just board it anyway, like the JTB buses in Waikiki to Ala Moana. So the other one is, of course, aside from costs, is about going to extend the rail system, the spurs, to Waikiki and to U.S. Manoa. elevator rail just won't cut it to Waikiki through Kuhio or whatever.
What a mess
going across the Alawai Canal, yeah. Building elevated rail and to spur to Mauna Loa. So automatically, even when we talk about spurs in the future, I think that's going to be a real challenge, even to plan out elevated at that point. Now, going back to at grade, we have a situation here that we can have not only the stations planned out, but we can also have elevated section that's already been in construction that stops already in Mill Street. So the FTA, the federal government, is asking for a response, and that's one of the things right on the table. By end of April, you have to give them working within a budget. What are you going to do after Middle Street?
So the idea would be they should listen to what you're saying. People should speak up on this issue. And they should include this in the plan. It goes to Middle Street, and it goes at grade. Simple enough, and right. Cheaper, way cheaper.
Right. It's according to the latest statement from the AIA Hawaii chapter, the whole report is focused on costs and cost overruns. Now, you have the first 10 miles, and they had 100 change orders and so forth. We don't know what's below downtown. We just don't know many things that are going to come up during construction. And so at grade, yes, that's much easier. Of course, it's going to take money to do that, but it's going to be far less than elevated.
Yeah. So what are the downsides? I mean, I just thinking right. The gadfly here, it would make noise right next to me. It would maybe stop the traffic as it crossed streets. I don't know. It could be a troublesome thing to have in your neighborhood. Tell me, how do you deal with that?
Well, the glass is half empty, half full, and I have to say that the Portland experience, that I think you've been there, has a mixture of rail, buses, cars, and pedestrians all intermingling at the same time. It has contributed to a renaissance of downtown Portland, in fact, economic, business, living activities, and that has been phenomenal for any downtown. Now, you're correct that in order to have the, from Middle Street onwards, you have to have a driver in the car. That's one thing, to navigate through the streets and so forth. So that means the current car configuration has to be redone. And also, there has to be a new way to electrify or power the cars. Right now, there's a third rail that's electrified all the time, and that can't be...
it's too dangerous.
It's dangerous for pedestrians, cars, et cetera. So you need a way to charge them the cars when they're over a contactless powering station. There are many technologies out there that's very innovative. Other cities are using it. They get powered up at the station, then they go for several stations, they get powered up again, and so forth. So you don't have the overhead nor the electrification along the railway.
Let's go one at a time and backward.
Yeah.
Okay. I think the technology is not a problem in terms of, my phone gets charged that
right.
way. Not a problem. It's not dangerous. It's probably much more high tech than the third rail. The third rail is dangerous, whoever is up there. Or down there, wherever it is. I mean, I remember I grew up in New York. The third rail was terrified
right,
people.
Right.
And there were a lot of unfortunate incidents with the third rail, which was going to happen as long as you have a third rail. This other technology, that's not going to happen. The other thing is you mentioned that it would resuscitate, revitalize neighborhoods, sort of like the way it has in Portland. And if anybody hasn't been to Portland, go to Portland. You'll see what I mean. It's a beautiful downtown. Everybody cares so much, and there's so many great shops and things to do. It's a walking city. I'm afraid to say Honolulu is not a walking city. It should be a walking city, and rail done properly at grade would make it a walking city. It would revitalize everywhere from the university all the way to the end of Chinatown and even further. And the result would be mom-and-pop businesses, lots of places you could go and have a nice outing. And spend your time and love the city. We do not have pride in our city. I think this would give us pride in our city. I don't see the noise as a real problem. It's not as noisy when you're down there on grade, right? Tell me.
No, it's not going to be that noisy because, of course, it can accelerate that fast. Right. And again, when we talk about the last 5-6 miles within from Middle Street to Ala Moana, the stations are 0.6 miles apart. They're quite close together. It's not like you're going for miles and miles on an accelerated track. It's quite short. And
so every time you accelerate or decelerate,
you're there at the next station. And so the people there, and you're correct about mass transit and the stations being the key to economic and cultural revitalization. Vancouver, Portland, many cities have seen billions of dollars being invested, like 500 feet, you know, around the line. You know, all kinds of new housing, new cultural symphonies, concert halls, shops, and so forth are invested in those areas. And so people get out, shop, you know, live, and then get back in and go ride it and so forth. So it becomes a kind of micro destinations along the line to really revitalize the city.
Yeah.
And to create neighborhoods around the stations.
Yeah. And it's lovely for tourists. So they would find it charming, like New Orleans, you know,
right.
Has a great at grade rail. Everybody takes the rail. It's charming. The fact that it moves more slowly than elevated rail, it doesn't bother me at all. I mean, I think we ought to move a little more slowly, and I don't think it's going to make any difference at all if there's a 5 or 10 minute variance on, you know, the amount of time you spend on the train. I think if you're at, it's like riding a bike, you know. If you're at grade, you see more. You
right,
can enjoy
right.
the city more, and the city can enjoy you more.
But you see, that's the point of rail. If you look at the cultural downtown renaissance, yes, all those factors come into play. But remember, the sales point of rail was to get people living in West Kapolei to downtown within a 40 to 45 minute window.
Mm-hmm.
That and then what happens when suddenly you're coming into Middle Street and things slow down? You see, I'm looking at it from a computer, commuter perspective,
mm-hmm.
that all of a sudden where you want to accelerate and get to your downtown, you know, law office or bank office in a hurry, things begin to slow down. So that's something that we have to deal with, that they that the commuters on the west side have to understand that there's going to be a system from Middle Street onto Waikiki.
That's slower than you, so what, though?
Yeah, that's a different world.
Different speed, that's okay. Yeah. They can enjoy coming into the city. It's like coming into Paris, kind of, you know. Slow down, relax.
And it may get people to move back into the city also.
I think it would.
And abandon their cars. Because one of the considerations, still, when you have stations in Kapolei or whatever, people drive there. So you're not, they're not abandoning their second or third car. They're still driving their car to a station, parking it, and then taking it to downtown.
Yeah. One other thing is you talked about automated versus, you know, actual human conductor. I don't have a problem with human conductors. You know, we have a price tag on this thing, 10, 12 billion, maybe more, I think more, if it goes the way it's supposed, the way it's set up to go now, anybody's guess. What's the cost of having a conductor there? Peanuts.
That's right.
It's tiny, right. tiny, infinitesimal cost.
A tiny sliver of total system cost.
I don't have a problem at all in putting a human conductor on. I think that'll actually be more charming, and that we need that. We'll take a short break, Ray.
Okay.
We'll come back and we'll talk about how we're ever going to figure out a way to do this and make it happen. You know, go from the transition from now to then. We'll be right back. You'll see. You'll see how it's done.
Hi, I'm Marianne Sasaki, and I'm here today to tell you about the Women's March on Washington on January 21st. It's an incredibly significant march in which all, both men and women are going to stand up for women's rights, women's reproductive rights, and all the rights we've accrued over the past 40 or 50 years. There's also going to be marches in each city, on each island. There's one in Oahu. I urge you to join a march and stand up for women's rights.
Aloha. I'm Reg Baker, the host of Business in Hawaii, that broadcasts live every Thursday from 2 to 2:30. Today, we were very fortunate enough to have Dr. Miller and her service dog, Muffin. We talked about the ADA, and we covered some of the different do's and don'ts of having service dogs in your establishment and how to sniff out the fakes. Please tune in for Business in Hawaii on Thursday to find out all about service dogs. Aloha.
Okay, we're back with Ray Tsuchiyama discussing probably one of the most important issues affecting our city and, you know, by inference, our state. And that's what we're going to do with rail here, because we're in so deep. We have unliquidated liabilities of $40 billion plus that we have no way to pay. And the ERS, the most recent scandal, $12 billion. When Abercrombie took over, it was $3 billion. Now it's $9 billion more on ERS. How are we going to get the money to afford any of this? This is going to kill us. They can make poor people really poor because, you know, the GET is regressive. That's the way the political establishment wants to go here, by putting a further regressive tax on people who really can't afford it and not raising the property tax. This is all backward. So many bad decisions. So here we are, and let's assume that you're right. Let's assume that people out there listening would say, let's do what Ray wants to do. How do you get to do that?
First of all, I am pro-rail.
I got it.
Pro mass transit. I've ridden millions of trains and subways in Tokyo, to Amsterdam, to Bangkok. I've been.
It's very efficient.
So, and I used to take one every day in Tokyo to work. That's one thing. The other thing is that I don't think that the people are looking at rail as part of, like you're saying, an economic, business, living, cultural renaissance for downtown Honolulu. I think we have to come back to that. First of all, that is an investment for more investment, by, especially from the private sector, because we've been talking about public-private partnerships, P3, for ages. We haven't really seen that, because we really haven't seen how there's an ROI, a return on investment for many businesses. The other one is, of course, that it is good for tourism. It is really good for, if you got people from Waikiki into Ala Moana, wow, they don't have to take the noisy bus.
The greatest attraction of all is to get them out of Waikiki, have them look at the local community, they see the local people.
They can go to Chinatown. Chinatown would be revitalized.
It would be.
And there'll be hundreds of tourists every day eating there, shopping there. There'll be whole new malls and so forth built right there around the station. So I don't think they're looking at it as a tax-generating mass transit kind of project. It's a tax drain. It's like we're trying to create a way for people to get to their office and go back again. And that's it. Kind of thing.
So it can be much more than that.
It's not a creative enterprise, and it's not a transportation issue. It's a real estate, infrastructure, cultural, business, kind of project. That those kind of people have to be part of the project, not the rail people, just the rail people, but people who can, you know, lease new restaurants or lease shops or create affordable housing near these stations. So there's a whole paradigm shift that you got to get out of. So going back to paying for rail and so forth, that is a very complex question, because a taxpayer looks at it and says, I'm going to give money, especially for the neighborhoods who are outside the state of Oahu, as they call the county of Honolulu. How to make this a project that you will see a lot of money coming in the future? And you can see that on return on investment. That has not been explored and explained to the people.
Yeah. So I give you the main question, which is coming up right now, this month, and in the months to follow during this session. Should we extend the extra 0.5% on the GET? And by the way, there are political issues about that. In the original time, it was, Linda Lingle wanted to effectively extort 10% of the amount collected from off the top for the state and give the balance to the city. The moves now are a way higher percentage, like 30% off the top for the state, and fill the general fund with it and then give the balance to the city. Ooh, that's awful, that's ooji. So the question though is, should we extend the GET in order to satisfy the FTA?
That's a really complex question, and I have to go back to why the FTA and the city and county are always talking to each other. In the United States, mass transit is a municipal responsibility. the city has to deal with it, and of course get federal funds to match it and so forth. But we're living in a state or a city and a state that the city has very few ways of raising money when you think about it. Even the coins into the meters going to the state and so forth. So whether the state follows or will acquiesce to the city's great project, that's a question mark.
It doesn't really help the state and the state legislators. It's not their project. And so, yeah, they could easily let the city roast in its own juices here.
The only way that the city really can raise money is through property taxes.
Yeah, which is very politically unpopular.
And nobody wants to go there.
Well,
because
it's the middle class or the upper middle class that owns the property.
Right.
And when they do a pushback, it's more powerful pushback.
That's right.
Since they're the ones who contribute to campaigns.
And also they vote. They vote
a
lot.
Yeah.
So that is... the city is between a rock and a hard place. There's very few ways to raise the money, and so they're beholden on going to the state for money. And the FDA is looking every day at what's happening
I recall, and there's no real predictability here, but I recall that Donald Trump said he was going to put big bucks into infrastructure, and this whole project is infrastructure. Does this make you feel more comfortable about federal funding, Ray?
Yes.
Notice the delay in the answer.
Yeah, yes and no. I think that the president-elect is looking at is things that will shore our infrastructure, because our highways are aging. Our ports need are ramping up to modernize. Our airports throughout the nation really needs to be much more security conscious and to be built up for more planes. So I don't know where a municipal 20-mile rail system will be a priority in the Trump administration. I don't know. I really don't know.
Yeah. Maybe not. I mean, it's just as, at this point, just as much likely as...
And remember that 67% of the Hawaii electorate voted for the other candidate.
He remembers that.
So we're thoroughly on the other camp. But I think, looking at the future, April, again, we keep delaying a big, big decision. But the elephant is in the room all the time. And April is still in the middle of the legislative session. And there are, alarms that we just don't know whether the laws will be really passed and signed and enacted to be able to be explained in detail to the FDA in a letter. So again, can that be changed? It was not June. June was a date where the legislative session would yield laws and regulations.
Yeah.
So they could take it to the FDA and say, we have the money and we will take it in this direction. So they have to think enormously and creatively until the end of April for the FDA to say that there is a viable system that ends at Ala Moana Center.
Well, I'm sure the mayor is trying to think of that. I mean, he's hitched his wagon on this project, and he's got to do everything he can to make it happen. He ran on that basis. But question, if I'm listening to this, or if I feel this way from historical reasons or current reasons, and I would like to scale it to ground level rail starting Middle Street, which I personally think is a great idea. What do I do to make my voice heard? What do I do to participate in making this happen? What do I do to save us from the complications of the existing elevated program?
I think the legislature really has to look at this much more closely than they've had before. I mean, the council has been wrestling with the issues a lot more. But here we have a state legislature that's maybe the key. It has to be the key, the funding mechanism in all this. And for the neighborhood boards and the people to go up to their legislators and say, you have to look at this very carefully as we go into the new funding tax scenarios that's coming up.
What I hear you saying, is very interesting, if not provocative, is that the legislature could say, okay, you want more money, we'll give you more money, but we have the power to attach conditions to that money. And we like Ray's plan.
It's not my plan. Yes.
Okay, a plan like this. Okay, and they said, we'll give you an extension of the GET. You can have it for X years, not forever, but for X years, and we'll help you out. Right. Maybe we'll even, you know, reduce the amount that we, the vigorish that we take off the top. But you've got to go to ground rail.
Well, that's the only people they would listen to. You go where the money is. If there is no money, you can't build it. And there is, I don't see any other source, a private or public otherwise, to come to the rescue. And so it is either, or you give it up, like Randy Roth said, you know, that's plan C on your show. So I'm not for that. I think we have to look at still at mass transit in some form going forward.
Yeah.
And it has to be synchronized with buses. That's very true. It has to be synchronized good software, with mechanisms that allow the trains at grade to go very quickly through congested streets, all the above. I mean, we have to try it, everything. But yeah. Right now, and get to a place where 20 years from now, we see huge amounts of investment in the inner city, and going from Waikiki all the way to Middle Street, and Kalihi has changed with new jobs, new housing, new malls. I mean, this could be a renaissance.
Transformational.
Yeah.
And that's what Scott Wilson and the other architects who are recommending this, and who have always recommended it, are thinking. They want to make a city that's pretty.
Right.
It's not pretty now, but it could be pretty, right. And this could be the transformational event to make it pretty. And I buy what he's saying completely. I think this would be fabulous for our city and would lead to pride, which we don't have now. Pride is something so important to bring a community together.
And when you go as a tourist to Vancouver or New York or San Francisco, when you say you're from Honolulu, they will say, oh, wow, that's where the greatest mass transit system is at. And the Honolulu, I love that city. It is the most innovative city in the world.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. Even to hear you say that. Well, tell people what they should do, Ray. You got 1 minute to give them your parting message.
My parting message is that we need to have everybody look at mass transit very carefully coming in the new 2017. There's been a whole history of it, and we don't have many options, but to look at one option of at grade rail, and other options exist, but I think it should be explored more, and I think that's a way to go forward that will save money and be more flexible, that will yield spurs to eventually Waikiki and Manoa.
And that brings us to the end of our show. We've enjoyed bringing it to you. I'm your host, Jay Fidel. Ray Tsuchiyama has been our guest. As always, he's so informative and productive in these discussions. We've been talking about, as you know, rail on the ground. Thanks to our production engineer, Zuri Bender, our floor manager, Robert McLean, and all the people who care about and contribute to our ThinkTech productions. If you want to see this show again, go to thinktechhawaii.com or youtube.com/thinktechhawaii, where there'll be a link to more shows just like this one. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. Aloha.